Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Yeah, good to see you. Making out in the rain, the stormy weather. Tomorrow's Martin Luther King Day, and I'm continuing in the sermon series, Keys to a Life of Joy and Fulfillment. And today, remembering Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, and I like to do this every year, bring a message on just the one of the keys to a life of fulfillment is learning from God's champions, learning from people God has worked through throughout history. And as you saw from Father Moon's message, he had chosen Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King wasn't a perfect man. I mean, definitely we can throw lots of stones at some of his shortcomings. But we can benefit if we grasp on to the good things and the successes that he did. So when Father Moon came to America, as you saw in the video there in the 1970s, he was looking for champions of God. Now, unfortunately, Martin Luther King had already been assassinated before that. But here's the words that you heard in the video from Father Moon. Father Moon said, Martin Luther King was God's chosen champion to fight bigotry and prejudice, proclaiming the equality of all races. He was not just assisting the black people's cause, he was assisting America's cause, bringing the nation closer to God's idea. So then also from Martin Luther King's last public message, it's called I've Been Up to the Mountaintop. That song was based on that message. Here's Martin Luther King. He says, well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop and I don't mind. He has a vision. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. Commitment. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we, as a people, will get to the promised land. And I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. So the very next day, he was assassinated after this speech. So there's three points I want to pull out from this champion that Father Moon identified. For a fulfilled life, we need to have a vision, we need to have commitment, and we need to take action. Our heart needs to guide our vision, our mind needs to be filled with commitment, and our will needs to guide us into action in our lives. So we're going to go through them one by one. So this is from another one of Martin Luther King's speeches about his vision. I'm convinced that the universe is under the control of a loving purpose, and that in the struggle for righteousness, man has a cosmic companionship. Behind the harsh appearances of the world, there is a benign power. I have a dream. I mean, so not only that, you know, he's talks about his vision of God as the loving God. And that this is the hope that we have, that vision, that God is not a God of judgment and punishment, but a God that desperately wants to bring healing to the world and is committed to that. So then when we talk about vision, Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech is a great statement of vision, of vision for the future. So let me just read some of it. I have a dream. It's his vision. that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. Actually, he offers up half a dozen dreams for America fulfilling its mission. You know, that will live up that the ideal of America, that the people who are conflict with each other, you know, the former slaves and the former slave owners will be embracing each other in brotherhood. That the places of injustice will be places of righteousness. The places of suffering will be raised up to be places of goodness. This is a vision, you know, a powerful vision for the hope for a future. And then near the end of it, he brings this together. He says, with this faith in that vision, with this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This is the power of vision. Vision that gives us strength to create a world of goodness. So, how about us for the Family Federation for World Peace? You know, our vision statement from President Naokimi Ushiroda. Our vision is a peaceful world where every family embodies God's true love. This is the core vision that we have of the kind of world we're living in. Also, the vision that we have is built around the three great purposes of our life, right? Becoming true individuals that know and experience God, becoming families and peoples of true love and relationships of true love, and having our relationship and dominion over all the things of the world based on true and caring love. So this is our vision as unificationists. So this is why it's important that we invest in study, to cultivate, to ground that vision in our hearts and mind, because this is what's going to give us the strength and power to bring it to pass. So on the foundation of filling our minds with this vision, then the next step is commitment. Committing ourselves, not just dreaming about it in you know, pie in the sky dream, but how do we bring it to pass? So here's some more words from Martin Luther King. This is actually quoted from the World Scriptures. This was included in our compilation of World Scriptures. Somehow, we must be able to stand up against our most bitter opponents and say, we shall match your capacity to inflict suffering by our capacity to endure suffering. We will meet your physical force with soul force. Do to us what you will, and we will still love you. Be assured that we'll wear you down by our capacity to suffer, and one day we will win our freedom. We will not only win freedom for ourselves, we will appeal to your heart and conscience that we will win you in the process. And our victory will be a double victory. This is a commitment, right? Commitment to sacrifice, even going the way of suffering and difficulty. Even no matter how much persecution comes, right? To be able to endure and to persevere. So, this is a quote from 1 Peter. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeals which come upon you to prove you, as though something were strange were happening to you. So, fiery ordeals are the norm, right? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. This is hard. How do we live unconditionally? Well, it's the commandments from Matthew. Love God first and love your neighbor. But don't be surprised when there's difficulties. So, here's from the divine principle. A fundamental nature of Satan is to aggressively encroach upon others. God's strategy is to claim victory after his side has been attacked first. Although countless prophets and saints have been sacrificed in the course of history, and even Jesus died on the cross, time and again, God claimed victory in the end. Although Satan's side was the aggressor in the First and Second World Wars, in the end, victory was won by the nations on God's side. God's true intention is having them endure these tribulations, and having them endure these tribulations was to have them stand on his side and secure the final victory. So unlike Martin Luther King, we're not pacifists. We believe, we should respond. Sometimes violence is necessary to defend and to protect others. But from a principal point of view, we should never initiate violence. We should never attack. One of the sad mistakes of America in recent time was when President Bush decided to preemptively attack Iran. Yeah. Because he thought Saddam Hussein was going to do something bad. Eleanor, can you help? So maybe if there was so much going on with behind the scenes, working with spiritual leaders, particularly Muslim leaders, to help bring a different kind of resolution and peace in Iraq. I may have misspoken. In Iraq. So when America initiated the attack, actually, God's grace left us. And so all kinds of difficulties have resulted from that. So God's side should never attack first. The challenge is, sometimes it's very uncomfortable to let yourself be hit, right? And not to strike first. Here's some words from Father Moon. He said, "You have received persecution, haven't you?" Yes. Everybody said yes. "Do you get angry or not?" Everybody said, "Yeah, we get angry." If you are angry, you should retaliate with love. Satanic people have attacked us in order to destroy us, but we will completely besiege them in order to save them. So this is Father Moon's guidance to us, is that even though we're attacked, and you know we're seeing it happen surprisingly, we thought a little bit we were past that, but all the difficulties happening in Japan. But we have to respond to the enemy with love. This is commitment. So in our lives of faith, we cultivate the vision through our study and understanding and developing a heart relationship with God. Then in our mind, we need to commit ourselves to bringing healing and restoration. That's what our lives are about. The difficulties and challenges we face, it's all about healing things, making things better, liberating the God and all people. This is the mission as unificationists that we carry. We're committed to comforting God's heart and to live a life of true love, filled with meaning, love for God, love for the people around us, and love for all things in nature and creation. But all this needs to be brought together and to put into action, making it real. So here's again from Martin Luther King. When we look beneath the surface, beneath the impulsive evil deed, we see within our enemy, neighbor, a measure of goodness, and know that the viciousness and evilness of his acts are not quite representative of all that he is. We recognize that his hate grows out of fear, pride, ignorance, prejudice, and misunderstanding. But in spite of this, we know God's image is ineffably etched in his being. Then we love our enemies by realizing that they are not totally bad, and that they are not beyond the reach of God's redemptive love. So loving our enemies, right? Putting that into action. We know that in our lives of faith, it's all about so many times making conditions to heal things, conditions of restoration, offerings of indemnity. You know, we make offerings through our commitment to study, through our prayer, through serving and service for others, through our tithe, our financial support, through witnessing, through sharing God's word with others. Following our conscience is how we grow. It's how we put into practice loving God, people, and all things of creation. And living that life of love and service, caring about others, and true love and service requires sacrifice. Sometimes it's I just sit back and say, oh yeah, I love you, but I'm not going to do anything that makes me uncomfortable. I'm not going to do anything that puts me out of my comfort zone, right? But genuine love means willing to sacrifice even my comfort for the benefit of others. Having that heart of a parent, as Father Moon often said, with heart of a parent and shoes of a servant, to live our life, to bring healing to the world. Finally, the big action that we're all called to do is God's calling us not just to be followers, but actually to be tribal messiahs, people who bring God's love and healing to the world and the environment around us. So all these things together, this is a fulfilled life. There's lots of examples in the world around us. And it's important, you know, one of the keys to living that life of fulfillment is finding those examples, those people in our life that we can learn from, especially looking at God's champions and pulling from them the power of vision, the strength we get from having a commitment, and the difference that we make in the world when we take action. So tomorrow, celebrating Martin Luther King Day, celebration of his life, I encourage you, take some time, listen to or read some of Martin Luther King's messages, his speeches, and reflect on how can this apply to me in my own life? How can I become also a champion for God? Someone that brings healing and blessing to the world around us. Please join me in prayer. Father, Mother God, our loving Heavenly Parent, we thank you so much for the models that we have, the champions that have gone before us, the people that we can learn from. And even if they didn't do everything right, we can glean from them. We can take from their lives the great victories that they did have and the areas of life where they excelled. And we apply that in our own life. Heavenly Parent, we are so grateful for your presence in our lives, for the vision that we have because of Father and Mother Moon, for their care and their investment, and the understanding we have through the unification teachings, and the examples we have of commitment. Heavenly Parent, we pray that we also will be people who commit ourselves to take action, and that our actions can be even taking us outside of our place that we're comfortable, to be people who make a genuine difference in this world. So we thank you, and together as your sons and daughters and as blessed sons or families, we offer up this prayer. Amen. And adieu.